I used a cheap logic analyzer to wiretap the conversation between my Milwaukee M18 battery and charger. And I got a whole bunch of gibberish. In order to decipher the Milwaukee Redlink protocol, we're going to have to short circuit, overvolt, undervolt, overheat, freeze, and touch the battery in its special spot. Quagmire Repair did a full PCB teardown of an M18 battery and posted some very useful schematics on their website. Buy it, fix it, figured out the basics of the battery to charger protocol, and also figured out the checksum and battery status byte. First up, these batteries are genuine Milwaukee M18 batteries. Milwaukee just uses different stickers and product codes outside of the Americas. M18 batteries have 5 pins. There's the 2 main power pins on the outside, a charging pin in the middle, and 2 other pins labeled J1 and J2. The charger doesn't use the positive power pin and instead sends power in through the middle charging pin. J2 is closest to the ground pin and is used by the charger to send messages to the battery. J1 is closest to the positive pin and is used by the battery to send messages to the charger. In order to document this digital mating ritual without spooking them, we need a few resistors. Without these, the logic analyzer makes J1 go limp and the charger gets frustrated and goes home. Also, the J2 pin is working at 12 volts, so we need to drop it down to around 5 volts for the logic analyzer to be able to read it. Easiest setup is to connect everything up and then plug the charger in. You may need something thicker than standard alligator leads, or else the charger senses a lack of interest and goes home. These ones are overkill, but they work. To record the signals, I'm using pulse view. This shows us the basic signal of high and low voltages. We can see the charger pull J2 high, which triggers the battery to pull J1 low, and then they start their mating ritual. The next step is to add a decoder and select UART, 2000 baud, and MSB first. We now get a slightly more human readable output in the form of hexadecimal numbers. Observing several mating rituals between two chargers and lots of batteries gives us multiple data streams that we can look for differences in. The first thing we notice is that there is no difference with different batteries or chargers. So devices don't have a unique ID and the charger is not taking any extra notice of the high output batteries and their bigger cells. There's only 5 different messages that I've found. First is a hello message, which the battery repeats. This is followed by I'm a charger and I'm available. Okay, watch your Snapchat, 0510F4. Hook up? Sure, but let me get ready. The charger is a bit socially awkward and repeats the same messages again, but this time around it says, I'm a charger, let's go, and the battery says, sure, give me 0 amps. After this, they get down to business and we get repeating messages of hook up and sure, give me 6 amps every half a second. The fifth and final message type is a weird little interrupt that happens every 300 seconds, where the charger says, let's change position. The battery says, alrighty, forces a break, they say hello, and then jump straight back into it. I think this is just done to calibrate for any clock drift. When charging is finished, the battery says sure, but not now. Then there's a 3-second pause and the charger asks hook up 4 times in a row, but gets no reply. The charger then initiates a reset and we go back to the beginning of the mating ritual. Looking at the actual bytes of each message, we see that all messages have a 3-byte header, an optional payload, and a 2-byte checksum that is simply the sum of all the other bytes. The 3rd byte of the header is easy as it's the number of bytes in the payload. The first byte from the charger is unique to each message. The battery's replies always start with 81 except for the interrupt where it is 80. When we look at these numbers in binary, we get the feeling that this first byte could be partitioned, with the first 2 bits describing the device type, the second 2 bits maybe a status, and the remaining bits could be a command. The second byte is a bit weird. In binary, we see a progression of ones being added to the left. My best theory is that this byte had to be added because the sum of bytes checksum is pretty much the worst checksum in existence and can very easily return false positives. For example, without the second byte, the 6-1 and 6-2 messages would only differ by 2 bits, and a small timing error could see a 6-1 command mistaken for 6-2. With the second byte, we now need 4 errors in precise locations for the 6-1 message to be mistaken for 6-2. It's still a terrible error detection strategy, but it's significantly stronger than not having that second byte. The I'm a Charger payload has four numbers that stand out when viewed in decimal. The 300 could be related to the 300 second interrupt, but it could be something completely different. The 6000 numbers are the milliamp rating of the fast charger. On byte fixits data, these bytes are 3000, which is the rating of the standard charger. So this is almost certainly the charger telling the battery what charging current it is capable of. The second last byte of I'm a Charger is 2 in the first exchange and changes to 1 in the second exchange. I think 2 means waiting and 1 means ready to charge. The last byte is decimal 13, which is the total number of bytes in the message including the checksum. The first message of the battery is just an empty message sent to acknowledge that it received the charger's proposition. I have no idea what 0510F4 means. It doesn't change no matter what I do to the battery, and the bytes aren't really meaningful in decimal or binary. The Shaw messages are fairly easy to decipher. Filming a full charge sequence and watching the charger lights and charging current shows that the first payload byte is a status byte. 1 is for constant current charging, 2 is for constant voltage, and 3 means I'm fully charged, stop. The second byte of the payload is always 04. It never changes, so I have no idea what it means. The last two bytes are the battery requesting a specific current from the charger. It matches closely with what I'm reading on the clamp meter. Now it's time to abuse our batteries and see how that changes our data stream. Overvolting one bank of cells with a power supply doesn't achieve anything. The battery just requests less current from the charger in order to hold that cell at 4.19 volts. And when the charger drops to 600 milliamps, it terminates charging. Maybe if someone's willing to hit it with 20 amps, we might see a cell over 4.2 volts and then get some sort of error. I set up a 6 ohm power resistor in parallel to pull half of the charging current away from the battery. This did not change states or give any errors, so there's no current sense in the battery during charging. Using power resistors to drain one cell did not reveal an undervoltage limit. I took a cell down to 0.92 volts and the charger still accepted it. Leaving the resistor on until it dropped to 0.89 volts did give an error, but this seems to be a comms error. The battery replies go to garbage for four messages and then the charger pulls low and errors. Overtemp test is done by shorting the thermistor with a 4.7 kiloohm resistor, and that tricks it into thinking it's overheated, and the data shows the status byte is now 4. Removing the resistor switches the state from 4 to 9, so I think 9 means ready to charge. I left a battery in the freezer for 48 hours, but I couldn't get anything. Not sure if it's not sensing low temp or if my freezer wasn't cold enough. I also desoldered a balancing rail to see what that would achieve, but the status byte just stayed at 03. The battery wouldn't run at all, but it reported itself to the charger as fully charged. Resoldering the connection got it to work on the tool again, but we now get the overtemp light on the charger. The data shows the status byte is 05, which I haven't seen in any other scenario. This battery appears to be toast. That's pretty much as far as I can interpret with what I've got. To get any further, I'm going to need other people to test their chargers and batteries and see if they can get different messages to what I did. Some things that might reveal more are the supercharger and a high output battery, and a brand new battery to see if there's some sort of initialization charge. Milwaukee M18 could one day be an endangered species, so it's important that we research their mating rituals now in case we need to set up a captive breeding program. Next, I'll be looking at how the batteries communicate with the tools. It's quite different to how they communicate with a charger, so I didn't include it in this video as I've probably exhausted most people's attention span for looking at digital signals. I've also done some work on reading the communications between the microcontroller and balancing chip, so hopefully we can get some answers as to why M18 batteries have so many balancing issues.